Dairy is a huge part of New Zealand. It contributes massively to our economy, making up 25% of our exports. Agriculture's always been the backbone of the country, but the perception of dairy is changing.
We have done very little over the last 10 years on climate change. The failure of the governments to bring the agricultural industry to heel is the problem.
Dairy cows are one of the most polluting animals you can farm, and we've filled our country with them. The massive growth of dairy over the last 30 years has come with negative impacts on our environment. Excessive fertilisers on our paddocks, pollution of our rivers, and high emissions contributing to climate change.
The right thing to do is for all of us dairy farmers to try to pull our weight, do what we can, and to find a way forward.
In this series, I investigate environmental issues down on the farm and seek solutions. Farmers are part of who we are as Kiwis, and so is the love of the environment we live in. These are big issues for all of us here in Aotearoa, in the land of milk and money. Looking at the New Zealand dairy industry, arguably the most urgent impact it has is on our climate, which is kind of weird when you think about it. I mean, normally when we talk about the climate crisis, it's alongside billowing factories and car exhausts. But here in New Zealand, our cows are actually more responsible for emissions than our cars. I want to figure out why that is and what we can do about it. I was too young in 2003 to be here when farmers protesting the fart tax drove a tractor up the steps of Parliament here. But I was here a couple of years ago when tens of thousands of students across Aotearoa protested demanding action on climate. So much has happened here, and this has been like the battleground of discussing climate effects in New Zealand. New Zealand's agricultural sector makes up half our greenhouse gases. Dairy alone is responsible for nearly a quarter of all the country's emissions. For most of the world, carbon dioxide is three quarters of emissions, with methane and nitrous oxide making up the rest. But due to the scale of agriculture here, the figures are quite different, with half our emissions coming from methane and nitrous oxide instead. Dairy's methane comes directly from the cows, who burp it out. The nitrous oxide comes from nitrogen fertilizer and is mostly released off puddles of cow urine. While methane doesn't last as long in the atmosphere as CO2, it does around 80 times more damage in the time it's there. Nitrous oxide actually lasts much longer than CO2 and is around 300 times more powerful, which is why scientists have identified quickly reducing these two gases as pivotal to combating the climate crisis. Our government's made commitments to doing its part in halting warming, but by all indications, we're failing. New Zealand's current efforts have been evaluated as insufficient by two leading climate organisations. Their data shows, if the world followed our example, the planet would experience a 4-degree rise by 2050, primarily because of our failure to properly address agricultural emissions. And some aren't taking that in action lightly, like Mike Smith, who's the climate chair for the Iwi Leaders Forum. He's actually suing the government and New Zealand's seven biggest emitting companies, including Fonterra and Dairy Holdings Limited, into taking stronger action on climate.
Successive governments have attempted to bring the agricultural sector into the ETS, the Emissions Trading Scheme, but they've failed, largely because of the power of the vested interests within the agricultural sector, and I think just a lack of courage on behalf of the politicians in bringing the agricultural sector in. I look at the faces of young children of today's generation, and they've got no idea what's coming. We know that the future is looking pretty grim. Now, what's required is action. I was invited to represent Māori people in New Zealand at the 1992 Earth Summit, which was held in Rio de Janeiro, and that was the first time that world leaders gathered to consider the issues around climate change. I was living in Kaiō, which is a small town not too far from here. We started experiencing devastating floods, which were reported at the time as being 1 in 100 year events, but they were happening every 2 months. It just became increasingly obvious that what the scientists had told us in 1992 was starting to manifest in front of our eyes. The impacts of sea level rise on Waitangi and many of our communities up here is going to be profound. We've got to dig up the bones of our ancestors. That's a process that's fraught with emotional difficulty and grief and anxiety. So what we're seeing here is part of the coastal erosion. It's coming as a result of the storm surges. I've seen this road halved, great chunks right to the white centre line taken out. They're fighting a battle against the ocean, and the ocean will win. Here we are outside the Whare Runanga. So it's built in 1940 to commemorate the 100 years since the signing of the Treaty of Waitangi. This is our pai pai. This is where the chiefs sit and sort out the businesses of the day.
Is that what we're doing?
So that's what we're doing. Sorting out the issues of our times.
So how do you see climate tying into Te Tiriti o Waitangi?
Te Tiriti o Waitangi guaranteed to protect our rights as Māori to our way of life. And nature is the highest form of law in our culture. We're not living with the laws of nature. We are destroying nature.
What role do you think industry like agribusiness, dairy has played in those breaches?
You only got to look at the history of the land wars. And they were fought in the Waikato, they were fought in Taranaki, and they were fought over on the east coast of the North Island around Whakatane. And those are the most fertile lands for agricultural pastoral farming. And so right from the get-go, agribusiness has been soaked in blood. Its history is a history of blood and death. I think we've got to go beyond sustainability, because what are we sustaining? Are we just sustaining this very limited, broken down environment that we're in? We're trying to sustain it to that level, or are we trying to build it back up again? So I think we've got to sort of start investing in nature. What the return is for that investment as being not necessarily in monetary terms, but in environmental and social returns. It's time to smell the kōwhai and to act.
In order to halt an increasingly disruptive climate of droughts, fires and floods around the world, we must halt global warming to a 1.5 degree rise by 2030, and by 2050 only be emitting as many greenhouse gases as can be absorbed. This is what our government committed to in the Zero Carbon Act of 2019. It makes reducing emissions part of the law, and came in part from pressure from young environmental activists. But for decades, agribusiness lobbying has managed to deflect any kind of climate regulation that would affect them. And again, with the Zero Carbon Act, they delayed regulation for their sector until 2025. Lisa McLaren was one of the driving forces behind the Zero Carbon Act.
I've been equal parts disappointed and furious at our agricultural leaders, how much misinformation they've put out about climate change. At the start, there was a real sense of anger towards climate policy. So I've been quite confused why the agriculture sector and farming communities haven't been championing this climate stuff for the last 30 years, because it's going to impact them just as much as it's going to impact other New Zealanders. I'm just sick of having to fight the lobby groups. They're much more funded than a bunch of young activists who are doing this in their lunch times and after work or uni. I saw year after year politicians were either trying to ignore the issue or dismiss that it existed, and I just got really angry. We needed a plan to get New Zealand on track.
When did you first start thinking about the climate growing up around here?
I think what really hit home for me was that climate change was in my own backyard. It was going to make this river flood more, which would impact our farm. That becoming more severe every single year, I didn't know how staying here would be viable if we didn't do something. New Zealand's known that we're going to have to do something about climate change for decades. So what we needed was something that would legislate the need for an actual plan, and that's what the Zero Carbon Act was set up to do. The Zero Carbon Act sets in motion a long-term target that New Zealand has to meet. It sets up a climate commission, which is to keep the government accountable to these targets. It puts in law the need to have a mitigation plan, so a plan on how to reduce emissions, and also an adaptation plan. So we've got a lot to prepare for, as well as reduce our emissions. So I've been chosen to go over to some of the climate negotiations, and I went to one in Warsaw and also the Paris Climate Talks, which is known for the Paris Climate Agreement. So I was there and saw countries sign the deal.
Where does New Zealand sit when we have those global climate conferences?
Because our ag emissions are so high, we've actually been one of the countries that's been quite disruptive in the climate negotiations, and it was almost embarrassing to be a New Zealander, and that's not something I've ever felt before actually, but delegates would come up and be like, I'm sorry that you're from New Zealand and that your country is choosing not to take action in a way that it could. I think we actually need transformational change, structural change. We need to be rethinking full farm system change, and we need to be thinking about that soon and getting all parts of the ag sector involved. It's in everyone's interest, and especially our rural community's interest, to get on top of this. We don't have a choice but to reduce our pollution. The alternative is too scary to consider. The impact on people, not just internationally, but our own communities as well. And it's not in 30 years, 40 years, it's this year and next year.
Despite dairy making up a quarter of our emissions, New Zealand is actually one of the most carbon efficient producers of milk in the world. Unfortunately, these efficiencies can't really make up for the fact that dairy cows are one of the most polluting animals you can farm, and we've filled our country with them. Dairy farmers like George Moss in the Waikato are trying to balance climate in cows through efficiencies, with research showing that you can slightly reduce on-farm emissions by using less imported feed and fertiliser and increasing the amount of milk each cow produces.
I've always been in a farming family. In 1981, my father encouraged us to do, probably was one of the very first dairy conversions from sheep and beef to dairy. In terms of climate change, I started off in the skeptics box. And then the science globally became more and more compelling that this was going to be a bigger issue. There's no simple solution. You start to fix the greenhouse gases, it potentially impacts on your profit. It potentially impacts on the number of people that you employ. Because we're a relatively low input farm, we could intensify, add very significant profit to the business and probably employ another family. But the downside to that, the quid pro quo, would be a massive increase in our greenhouse gas footprint. What is the greater good? Is it employment? Is it profit and paying taxes? Is it greenhouse gas reduction? They are competing pressures. It is a wicked problem. The right thing to do is for all of us dairy farmers to try to pull our weight, do what we can, and to find a way forward. What we need is leadership that will take us forward to a place that we're probably uncomfortable going. I think legislation has to be there to provide the motivation for change. We know some people will not, so we need courts with a stick that says, well, if you won't, I will sort it out for you. It's a small proportion, but they have tainted the rest of us. It's one of the downsides of being in dairy. We've all got lumped together as if we all perform the same or have the same problems. One of the things that we're trying to do for our farm is reducing the number of cows. We'll get some wins by actually reducing the amount of nitrogen that we actually apply, which will reduce the amount of nitrous oxide. We do believe that we are custodians of the land, and we do believe that we are building something that is better. But at the end of the day, it's about the people and helping people find solutions, trying to find the way forward, trying to find that sweet spot between profit and environmental footprints.
Unless we reduce the number of cows we have, it won't be possible to meet our climate goals through on-farm efficiency alone. And so the industry spent the last 20 years researching technological solutions to reduce emissions, things like new foods and vaccines. These are often referred to as silver bullets, a single solution that would work quickly to fix the problem, but without having to change anything else. There's actually a bit of early research that's found a seaweed that, when fed constantly to a cow, could reduce its methane production by up to 98%. Unfortunately, for it to be that effective in New Zealand, we'd have to house all of our cows and feed them through a trough. Michael Lakeman started a company that's looking to cultivate the seaweed and hopefully reduce methane from cows here and around the world.
CH4 Global is a startup that's focused on zero methane agriculture. We do that by growing a seaweed called Asparagopsis, that when you feed it to livestock, reduces the methane emissions.
What do we got here?
So this is the climate cooling solution.
It's so humble.
It is humble. At this scale, it's humble. Really not a lot to it. It's a little branching, tufted red seaweed.
What is it about this seaweed that means that we can mitigate ruminant methane emissions?
There is an active compound that the seaweed produces and concentrates that's called bromoform. See if you can smell that. It's a light kind of chemically smell to it.
It's not unpleasant. It smells quite nice.
It's palatable to both humans and livestock.
We know there's huge demand, 1.5 billion cows on the planet. They're going to eat a lot of seaweed.
And so you could continue to grow more and more asparagopsis in this kind of environment?
Yeah, exactly. This will just continue growing, dividing.
What food does it require?
This is seawater, and all of the food that the plant needs comes out of that.
Where's the seaweed coming from? That's the big obstacle that remains to be addressed. The scale of production that would be required if we were to grow the seaweed out in the ocean would be the amount of open ocean space that is currently used for current aquaculture. So you think in New Zealand, we're currently growing mussels and salmon and oyster, and there's an amount of aquaculture space used for that. Same again in the seaweed, and all of a sudden, a third of New Zealand's greenhouse gas emissions are wiped out.
What scale of quantity will we have to produce to feed New Zealand's dairy cows enough asparagopsis to mitigate their methane emissions?
For one cow each day, we expect a dosing of about 100 grams of dried asparagopsis. This is all of about 5 grams.
Right, so about 20 times that.
20 times this per cow per day.
All the research in feed trials has been in systems like feedlot, where you're controlling the diet in every mouthful that the cow eats. New Zealand being a pastoral grazing system, we need to be able to feed the supplement to the cows, maybe twice daily during the milking period. The effectiveness and methane reduction from feeding twice daily, it's an unknown.
How intensive would it be, the drying process of the quantity of seaweed that you're talking about?
Because the seaweed and its active ingredient, bromoform, is quite delicate, the seaweed has to be dried quite carefully.
Right.
So it requires a level of energy intensity that's probably a little more than you'd see with dried milk solids.
That's just the issue of gaseous emissions. You still have other challenges that dairying or livestock farming in New Zealand present. Carbon dioxide, nitrogen, and nitrous oxide emissions still need to be tackled. If asparagopsis delivers the results that we believe it's going to, that does not reduce in any way the pressure or the importance on farmers and of the livestock industry to address the other challenges. I don't think that the New Zealand public is going to accept dirty water but clean skies. You've got to have clean skies and clean water. What you need is many solutions coming at different angles to tackle these global issues.
Is there a silver bullet for climate? It turns out it doesn't really exist. What we need is a silver buckshot, hundreds of smaller solutions rather than just one big one. In the next episode, we'll look at the basis upon which all of these solutions will be built, the whenua, the land and soil of Aotearoa.